Hello students, I am Dr. Neela Mahajan. I shall be discussing suppositories and pessaries, part 2, formulation and manufacturing. In this module, we will learn about the formulation aspects and concerns of suppositories, manufacture of suppositories, packaging of suppositories, and evaluation of suppositories. Let us talk about the formulation aspects of suppositories. Formulation aspects of suppositories include finding out pre-formulation information regarding their end use, which can be local or systemic, their site of application, which can be rectal, vaginal or urethral, and their nature of desired effect, which can be quick, slow and prolonged. Second aspect involves evaluation of preliminary suppository basis by measuring drug availability from the suppository in water at 36 to 37 degrees Celsius. Stability determination of both active ingredients and base containing drug at 4 degrees Celsius and room temperature. It also includes simultaneous study of ease of molding and release in the manufacturing equipment so as to reduce the number of suppository bases chosen for stability studies. Lastly, it involves the measurement of toxicity and drug availability in animals before the medication is ready for human clinical trials. Now we will discuss the formulation aspects of suppositories for systemic effect. These involve selection of potential desirable suppository bases based on their availability and cost before initiating formulation work. Ensuring drug release at desired rate to the aqueous body fluids surrounding the suppository requires knowledge of solubility of the ingredient in water or other solvents. For drugs favoring water, a fatty base with low water number may be preferred. However, for highly fat soluble drug, a water type base in combination with a surfactant to enhance solubility is often preferred. Fluid content in the rectum is small, therefore, in vitro findings of release rates in which comparatively large amounts of water are generally used can be regarded only as a general guideline for formulation and after the formula is in production as a quality control procedure. In many cases, there is reasonable correlation of in vitro to in vivo release rates, but this is not necessarily so. In vivo clinical findings in man are the ultimate criteria for choosing a desired suppository formulation which yields the in vitro release rate pattern used as the desired standard. The clinical findings may be based on blood levels of the drug and desired clinical effects in man. Therefore, since the suppository formula is not chosen until desired clinical effects in man are determined, screening of several prototype formula by laboratory tests is the practiced procedure. Ensuring the homogeneous dispersion of drug in base by enhancing the homogeneity of the drug in the desired base. This is done by using a suitable solvent or finally comminuting drug before incorporation. The drug soluble in a minimal quantity of water or in another liquid miscible with the base can be dissolved and their solution added to the molten base. For direct incorporation into the base, drug should be finally ground. Studying chemical and physical stability, consistency of in vitro drug release patterns within theoretically desired ranges and animal toxicity before choosing suppository formulas for human clinical trials is another aspect. Out of the potential formulae chosen for intense human clinical studies, at least two formulations, each containing different batches of acceptable quality ingredients, are placed on prolonged stability tests. Suppositories are stored at room temperature and at 4 degrees Celsius. They are tested at regular intervals for changes in appearance, melting and softening range, drug stability, base stability, and in vitro drug release pattern. The minimum age of the samples used in clinical trials depends on the stability of the melting range of the formula, since nearly all shift upward initially, but the time required to reach equilibrium varies. Now, the formulation aspects of suppositories for local effect. Drugs intended for local action are generally non-absorbable. For example, drugs for hemorrhoids, local anesthetics, and antiseptics. Bases used for these drugs are virtually non-absorbable, slow in melting, and slow in drug release, as contrasted with suppository bases intended for systemic drugs. Local effects are generally delivered within half an hour and last at least 4 hours. Formulation aspects of suppositories for local effects include selection of the base intended for local action, homogeneous distribution of the drug in suppository base. This is accomplished for incorporating the drug in a systemic base. The third aspect is testing the suppository 48 hours after molding by immersion in a 37 degree Celsius water bath. The desired base should release an adequate amount of drug within half an hour and completely melt with release of all drug between 4 and 6 hours. A suppository that does not melt within 6 hour test period would probably not completely release its drug, because discomfort to the patient will be there and it will be expelled by the patient before it is fully utilized. Now we will discuss the major formulation concerns for suppositories. The first concern is water in suppositories. Use of water as a solvent for incorporation of substances in the suppository bases should be avoided due to certain reasons. First reason being, water accelerates the oxidation of fats. If water evaporates, dissolved substances crystallize out. Moreover, unless water is present at a level significantly higher than that which is required for dissolving the drug, water has little value in facilitating drug absorption. Absorption from water-containing suppositories is enhanced only if an oil in water emulsion is existing with more than 50% of the water being in the external phase. Reactions between ingredients contained in suppositories are more likely to occur in the presence of water. Sometimes anhydrous chemicals are used to avoid this possibility. Incorporation of water contaminated with bacterial or fungal growth requires addition of bacteriostatic agents like the parabens. The next formulation concern is hygroscopicity. Glycerinated gelatin suppositories lose moisture by evaporation in dry climates and absorb moisture under conditions of high humidity. Polyethylene glycol bases are also hygroscopic. Rate of moisture change in these bases depends not only on humidity and temperature, but also on the chain length of the molecule. As the molecular weight of these bases increases, the hygroscopicity decreases with a significant drop for 4000 and 6000 series. Now the next concern, incompatibilities. Polyethylene glycol bases are incompatible with silver salts, tannic acid, aminopyrene, quinine, ethanol, aspirin, benzocaine, and sulfonamides. Many chemicals tend to crystallize out of polyethylene glycol, for example, sodium barbital, salicylic acid, and camphor. Higher concentrations of salicylic acid soften polyethylene glycol to an ointment-like consistency, and aspirin complexes with it. Penicillin G, although stable in cocoa butter and other fatty bases, is found to decompose in polyethylene glycol bases. Fatty bases with significant hydroxyl values may react with acidic ingredients. Viscosity is the next important concern. Viscosity of the molten suppository mass is important in the manufacture of suppository and to its behavior in the rectum after melting. Molten cocoa butter and some of its substitutes have low viscosities, whereas glycerinated gelatin and polyethylene glycol type bases have viscosities considerably higher than cocoa butter. In the manufacture of suppositories made with low viscosity bases, extra care must be exercised to avoid the sedimentation of suspended particles. Poor technique can lead to non-uniform suppositories, particularly in the distribution of active ingredients. To prevent segregation of particles suspended in molten bases, the well-mixed mass should be handled at the lowest temperature necessary to maintain fluidity, constantly stirred without entrapping air, and quickly solidified in the mold. The approaches which may help to overcome the problems caused by the use of low viscosity bases include using a base with a more narrow melting range that is closer to body temperature, including approximately 2% aluminum monostearate, which not only increases the viscosity of the fat base but also helps in maintaining a homogeneous suspension of insoluble materials, and lastly addition of cetyl, stearyl or myristyl alcohols or stearic acid to improve the consistency of suppositories. Brittleness is another very important concern for suppositories. Brittle suppositories are troublesome in manufacturing as well as in the subsequent handling, wrapping and use. Brittleness can be overcome if the temperature differential between the molten base and mold is as small as possible. Addition of a small amount of plasticizer like Tween 80, Tween 85, fatty acid monoglycerides, castor oil, glycerin or propylene glycol imparts plasticity to a fat and makes it less brittle. Suppositories made from cocoa butter are quite elastic and do not fracture readily. Synthetic fat bases with a high degree of hydrogenation and high stearate contents have a higher solid content at room temperature are usually more brittle. Fracturing of the suppository made with such bases is often induced by rapid chilling of the molten bases in an extremely cold mold. Density is the next major concern for suppositories. Knowledge of the density of the base to calculate the amount of drug per suppository is required. Volume of the mold cavity is fixed and weight of the individual suppository varies with the density of the mass. Suppository weight can be obtained from a given mold and density of the chosen base. Active ingredients can then be added to the bulk base in such an amount that the exact quantity of drug is present in each molded suppository. Density is not the sole criterion for calculating suppository weight per fixed volume of mold. When volume contraction occurs, suppository weight is determined empirically by small batch runs. Volume contraction occurs in many molten suppository bases after cooling in the mold in two ways. The first way is good mold release. It is caused by the mass pulling away from the sides of the mold. This contraction facilitates the removal of the suppositories from the mold, eliminating the need for mold release agents. Second way involves undesirable contraction with hole formation at the open end of the mold. This results in lowered suppository weight and imperfect appearance of the suppository. Contraction can be eliminated by pouring a mass slightly above its congealing temperature into a mold warmed to about the same temperature. If adequate control of temperature is not feasible, mold is overfilled so that excess mass containing the contraction hole can be scraped off. Cocoa butter adheres to suppository molds because of its low volume contraction. Hence, cocoa butter suppositories are difficult to remove from the molds, and various mold lubricants or release agents must be used to overcome this difficulty. They can be applied by wiping, brushing, or spraying. Their examples include mineral oil, an aqueous solution of sodium lauryl sulfate, various silicones, alcohol, and tincture of green soap. If volume contraction occurs in the mold during cooling, additional compensation must be made to obtain the proper suppository weight. The next major concern for suppositories is dosage replacement factor. Amount of base that is replaced by active ingredients in suppository formulation can be calculated. The replacement factor F is derived from equation which is shown over the screen, where E is the weight of pure base suppositories, G is the weight of suppositories with X percent active ingredients. After dosage replacement factor, weight and volume control is another major concern for suppositories. Amount of active ingredient in each suppository depends on its concentration in the mass, volume of the mold cavity, specific gravity of the base, volume variation between molds. Good machining of the molds should keep the volume of each cavity within 2% of a desired value. Weight variations between suppositories due to inconsistencies in the manufacturing process, like incomplete closing of molds, uneven scrapings. Regardless of the reason for the variation in weight, it should be within plus minus 5%. Last but not the least, rancidity and antioxidants also constitute one of the major concerns for suppositories. Acidity of fats should not be confused with rancidity. Presence of free fatty acids in either small or large quantities is not an indication of rancidity or that such a product may necessarily become rancid. Rancidity results from auto-oxidation and subsequent decomposition of unsaturated fats into low and medium molecular weight saturated and unsaturated aldehydes, ketones, and acids with strong unpleasant odors. Lower the content of unsaturated fatty acid constituents in a suppository base, greater is its resistance to develop rancidity. Since this reaction begins with formation of hydroperoxides, a measure of auto-oxidation in progress is peroxide value. This peroxide or active oxygen value is a measure of the iodine liberated from an acidified solution of potassium iodide by the so-called peroxide oxygen of the fats. Examples of effective antioxidants are phenols like meta or para diphenols, alpha naphthol, quinones like hydroquinone or beta naphthoquinone. Now that we are familiar with the various formulation aspects and various formulation concerns for suppositories, let's see how many methods are used to manufacture suppositories. Four methods are used in preparing suppositories, namely molding by hand, compression, pour molding, and compression on a regular tablet press. The first method, that is molding by hand, is the simplest, oldest, practical, and economic method for manufacture of small number of suppositories. A suppository is prepared by hand by rolling the well-blended suppository base containing active ingredients into desired shape. Base is first grated and then kneaded with active ingredients by using a mortar and pestle until the resulting mass is plastic and thoroughly blended. Active ingredients are usually finely powdered or dissolved in water or sometimes mixed with a small amount of wool fat to help incorporation with the suppository base. Mass is then rolled into a cylindrical rod of desired length and diameter or into vaginal balls of intended weight. Starch or talcum powder on the rolling surface and hands prevent the mass from adhering. The rod is cut into portions and then one end is pointed. The second method is compression molding. This method avoids heat, is relatively simple, and results in a more elegant appearance. It avoids the possibilities of sedimentation of insoluble solids in the suppository base. One of the major disadvantages in the use of cold compression method for molding fat type base suppositories is unavoidable air entrapment. This makes close weight control impossible and favors possible oxidation of both the base and the active ingredients. Suppository mass is forced into a mold under pressure using a wheel operated press. The mass is forced into mold openings, then pressure is released, mold is removed, opened, and replaced. Pressure is applied via a piston to compress the mass into mold openings, which usually comprises of three cavities. The third method is pour molding. It is the most commonly used method for producing suppositories on both a small and a large scale. First, the base material is melted, preferably on a water or steam bath to avoid local overheating. And then the active ingredients are either emulsified or suspended in it. Finally, mass is poured into cooled metal molds. Last method of preparing suppositories involves the use of automatic molding machine. The molding operations can be performed by machine. All filling, ejecting, and mold cleaning operations are fully automated. Output of a typical rotary machine ranges from 3500 to 6000 suppositories per hour. In the rotary molding machine, chrome plated brass molds are installed radially in the cooling turntable. First of all, the prepared mass is fed into a filling hopper where it is continuously mixed and maintained at constant temperature. Suppository mold is lubricated by brushing or spraying and then filled to a slight excess. After the mass solidifies, excess material is scraped off and collected for reuse. All pumping and scraping units are heated electrically at controlled temperatures. Cooling cycle is adjusted as required by individual suppository mass by adjusting the speed of the rotary cooling turntable. Solidified suppositories are moved to the ejecting station where mold is opened and suppositories are pushed out by steel rods. The mold is closed and then moved on to the spraying station for lubrication and a repeat of the cycle. Temperatures and output speeds are regulated to create optimal conditions for continuous automatic production. Molds must be kept clean to prevent any deposition of mass from interfering with their proper closure. Incomplete closure of the molds results in overweight suppositories with mold marks. Air jets blow loose particles out of the molds and thus help to minimize machine time for cleaning. On the straight line machine, molds are arranged for increased productivity up to about 10,000 suppositories per hour. Straight line machine carries out molding similar to the rotary machine. The individual molds are carried on a track through a cooling tunnel where scraping off and ejection occurs. So we discussed the various methods of preparing suppositories. After molding, the suppositories are packaged. Now we will be discussing the various packaging requirements. Suppositories must be overwrapped or they must be placed in a container in such a manner that they do not touch each other. Overwrapping of suppositories is done by hand or machine. Suppositories usually are foiled in tin or aluminium. Paper and plastic strips are also used. Individually wrapped suppositories are usually packaged in slide, folding or setup boxes. Occasionally, hygroscopicity or volatility of ingredients necessitates packaging the suppositories in glass or plastic containers. In the case of glycerinated gelatin suppositories, a well-sealed package is required. Many suppositories are not individually wrapped and are placed into cardboard boxes or plastic containers with molded compartments. In one type of machine, chill-hardened suppositories are placed in a nosed turntable and then fed to the packaging station where the foil is unwound from a roll, cut to size and finally rolled around each suppository. In other machines, suppositories are enclosed in cellophane or heat-sealing aluminum foils. Now let's talk about in-package molding. Automated methods mold suppositories directly in their wrapping material. Machines utilizing plastic either thermoform the mold and fill the mold in sequence or simply fill the mass into previously thermoformed molds. Machines using aluminum foil or polypropylene or lacquer laminates emboss two parallel strips of foil so that when they are sealed together, molds are formed. In both plastic and aluminum approaches, tops of the molds are left open for entrance of filling nozzles. After the mass has been injected, usually by means of small variable throw piston pumps, the tops are sealed. Strips are then passed in an upright position through a cooling station. Using these techniques, one machine can make 12,000 to 20,000 suppositories per hour. Now the advantages of in-package molding. In-package molding offers many advantages including high production rates, no generation of scrapings, no bulk handling or storage of unwrapped suppositories, and maintenance of strict temperature controls. Disposable molds are suitable for suppositories intended for tropical climates. If mass melts at high storage temperatures, the mold still retains it in its proper shape so that upon cooling, it can be dispensed without distortion. The disadvantages of in-package molding include dependence on the shape of the formed mold and seal completeness for the shape of the suppository and depression formation in the rear of the suppository since no scraping takes place. Once the suppositories have been manufactured, they are evaluated. Now we will discuss the various evaluation aspects of suppositories. Finished suppositories are routinely inspected for appearance and after being sliced lengthwise for uniformity of the mix. They are assayed for active ingredients to ensure that they individually conform to the labeled content. In addition, certain screening tests are performed before the time-consuming and costly animal and human tests can begin. These include melting grain test, softening point test, dissolution test, etc. Melting range or macro melting range is the first screening test. Melting range tests are performed to check the physical and absorption characteristics of each manufactured batch of suppositories. It is a measure of the time it takes for the entire suppository to melt when immersed in a constant temperature water bath. Micro melting range test is the melting range measured in capillary tubes for fat base only. The next screening test is softening time test of suppositories. This is a quality control check carried out at temperatures ranging from 35.5 to 37 degrees Celsius and can serve as a measure of physical stability over time. Softening time test apparatus consists of a U-tube partially submerged in a constant temperature water bath. A constriction on one side holds the suppository in place in the tube. A glass rod is placed on top of the suppository and the time for the rod to pass through to the constriction is recorded as the softening time. A water bath with both cooling and heating elements should be used to assure control within 0.1 degree Celsius. Now, breaking test. The breaking test measures the breaking point of suppository, which is the force that determines the fragility or brittleness characteristic of the suppository. The desired breaking point of suppositories is established as the level that withstands the break forces caused by various types of handling, including production, packaging, shipping, and patient in-use handling. Apparatus used for test comprises of a double wall chamber in which test suppository is placed. Water at 37 degrees Celsius is pumped through the double walls of the chamber, and suppository contained in the dry inner chamber supports a disc to which a rod is attached. The other end of the rod comprises of another disc to which weights are applied. Test is conducted by placing 600 grams on the platform. At 1 minute interval, 200 gram weights are added, and the weight at which the suppository collapses is the breaking point. Fragility tests are carried out to ascertain that the suppositories can be packaged and shipped with minimal breakage. The next screening test is disintegration or dissolution testing. The theoretically desirable suppository formulations are molded in the laboratory and stored at room temperature for at least 48 hours before undergoing in vitro testing for release rate. In vitro testing for release rate testing of drugs from suppositories has always posed a difficulty owing to melting, deformation, and dispersion in the dissolution medium. Early testing was carried out by simply placing in a beaker containing a medium. In order to control the variation in mass-medium interface, a wire mesh basket or a membrane to separate the sample chamber from reservoir has been used. Samples sealed in dialysis tubing or natural membranes, flow cell apparatus holding the sample in place with cotton, wire screening, and most recently with glass beads have also been used. Lastly, the suppositories are tested for the effects of handling. To test the effects of handling the suppositories in the field, these are often shipped by the desired transport facilities to several areas in the country and then tested physically and occasionally chemically for stability. So, students, in this module, we have learned about the various formulation concerns and aspects of suppositories, manufacturing of suppositories, packaging of suppositories, and various tests used for evaluation of suppositories. Thank you.